Yes, a very good morning. Right, so again a lot of good morning wishes today, like every day. Today I've got a Shubh Sakhar also, so that's from Maharashtra. Right, and then again from Telangana and Rajasthan and all over India. Right, somebody is saying audit paper Raksha Bandhan ke din hai, so that anyways doesn't have any significance. For you it is the day of a life, in the life of a CA student. That is the simple way for you to look at it. Okay, right, so Jai Shri Krishna and Narsingh Chaudhas and so many other, Bolo Radhe Radhe, and oh my god, I think it's going too far. Yes, wonderful to see all of these. Right, so hope that you have looked into the chapter of the clauses of the tax audit also. You have done writing of a few of them. Right, so tomorrow we'll be discussing GST, and then before GST I've also decided that a few other questions also I will discuss with you. Tomorrow and day after is going to be the MCQ, right, the multiple choice questions which we are going to be discussing. So before we come to the tomorrow's discussion on the MCQ, I want you to go through the MCQ videos which are already uploaded on the YouTube channel. Right, so that you know you are warmed up, so that you don't have the backlog of those videos first. Right, so there are some 9 videos, okay, it's a series of MCQ videos which are uploaded for CA final students. Right, so if you've seen them already, wonderful, you could brush up with them. If you've not seen them so far, I would insist, you know, because MCQ is again a matter of practice. You have to develop the knack, right? Your guessing skills have to improve. That is the art of, you know, solving an MCQ and getting the correct answer, right? Eliminating the wrong answers, reaching to the correct one, right? That knack needs to be developed. Right, so before we begin for today, I thought let me give you the homework for today. So you need to look into the MCQs, you need to brush up. And certainly tomorrow and day after, we will be looking into a lot of multiple choice questions. Okay, right, so let me discuss say a few other questions from different chapters with you before I come to the chapter on the discussion on the GST audit. Okay, removal of auditor by the tribunal or the CG in case where the auditor has acted in a fraudulent manner. Right, I am talking about section 140 subsection 5, right, of the Companies Act 2013. Right, Suchita Pandey is mentioning that today I started meditating for 15 minutes after watching yesterday's video. Right, so wonderful, I am very happy about that. Okay, right, so section 140 subsection 5 of the Companies Act 2013, which is regarding the removal of the auditor by the tribunal or the central government. And why tribunal or central government is taking the step for removal of the auditor? Because they think that the auditor, they've come to know that the auditor has acted in a fraudulent manner. Right, section 140 subsection 5, recently trending in the exams. Right, recently trending. Right, so how do you start an answer? The tribunal either suo moto, that is on its own, right, or based on an application received from the central government or any person concerned, right, is satisfied. The tribunal either suo moto or based on an application received from the central government or any person, concerned person, is satisfied. The tribunal is satisfied. What? That the auditor of the company has acted in a fraudulent manner. Right? The auditor of the company has acted in a fraudulent manner or has abated. Abated means helped, assisted, aided. Right? Or abated or colluded. That is joint effort. In any fraud by or in relation to the company or its directors or officers, it may by order direct the company to change its auditors. Right, so removal of the auditor by the tribunal or the CG. What does the sentence start with? Right, tribunal either suo moto or based on an application received from the CG or any person concerned is satisfied that the auditor of a company has acted in a fraudulent manner or has abated or colluded. Yes, technical jargon, technical words, very, very, very important in audit paper. Right, abated or colluded in any fraud by or in relation to the company or its directors or officers, it may by order direct the company to change its auditors. If the application is received from CG and the tribunal is satisfied that the auditor has acted, abated or colluded, then the final order has to be passed by the tribunal within 15 days and the new auditor will be appointed by the central government. Right, third point, such an auditor against whom the final order has been passed by the tribunal cannot be appointed as an auditor of any company for a period of 5 years and shall be liable under section 447. Right, and shall be liable under section 447. Right, and the liability shall be of the firm and every partner of the firm who acted, abated or colluded. Okay. Right, so that is regarding the disgrace, the removal of the auditor by the tribunal or the CG. Right, say another question which we could discuss is regarding the contents of the due diligence report. Right, the contents of the due diligence report. Right, what are the contents of the due diligence? Yes, check sound. Any problem coming with the sound? Right, sound, it's the same setting like yesterday, but don't know what could be the possible reason for the same. Right, echo coming, okay, but I am not sound issue, okay. Check sound. How do I check for that? If I remove this camera, connection may go. It's good. The sound now, is it better? Echo? Oh, many of them. Now sound okay, ma'am? Okay, so is it fine for all good? Wonderful. Okay, right. So another question which I talked to you is ERA ERG. No. ERA ERG is, that is Bhaskari Sri, that is the contents of the forensic audit report. Right now I am talking to you about the contents of the due diligence report. And it can't happen that they are asking you for, you know, tomato vegetable and you're giving them potato vegetable. And if you ask somebody that serve me tomato vegetable which is cooked and you're giving them potato, not done. Right now I'm talking, it's a cross connection. No, simply you dial one number and another person picks up the phone, that type of a situation. Right, so right now I'm talking about the contents of the due diligence report. ERA ERG, what is mentioned over there, that is the contents of the forensic audit report. Right now I'm talking about the due diligence report. Right, so what are the contents of a due diligence report? Introduction, objective and scope. Right, history of the company, the background of the promoters. Right, the shareholding pattern and the management structure. Right, the financial status and the operating results. Hidden and contingent liabilities, statutory and tax liabilities. Any lien or charges created against the assets. SWOT analysis. Right, and suggestions regarding points to be taken care of before and after the merger or acquisition. Right, what did I discuss with you right now? The contents of the due diligence report. Right, what are the contents of the due diligence report? Introduction, then objective and scope. Right, then the shareholding pattern and the management pattern. Right, the history of the company, background of the promoters, financial status and the operating results, hidden and contingent liabilities, statutory and tax liabilities, SWOT analysis, any lien or charge created against the assets and suggestions regarding the points to be taken care of before and after the merger or acquisition. Okay, right, so that is one more question which I could discuss with you. Say another question which we could discuss is regarding the current period consolidation adjustments. Right, have you finished studying the chapter on the audit of the CFS? One of the very important chapter in your remaining syllabus. Right, almost every exam we see one question coming from there. And that particular chapter has a special feature, you know, that the question bank is bigger than the chapter. Right, because there are a lot of case studies, lot of questions which have been asked from the chapter of the consolidated financial statements. Right, so one question over there. Right, so one question over there. Error, YouTube is not receiving enough video to maintain smooth streaming as such view. Okay. Right, let's see how it goes ahead. Right, so now talking about over there, the current period consolidation adjustments, right? What are the current period consolidation adjustments? The intra-group profits, the intra-group interest, the intra-group indebtedness, all intercompany transactions are required to be eliminated. right? So intra-group profits, intra-group interest, intra-group indebtedness. Then we also have the harmonization of the accounting policies, right? In case if the accounting policy is being followed by the parent company and the components, they are not consistent, then in that case, the harmonization of the accounting policies, right? Then in case if some of the component has prepared their financial statements as per some foreign GAAP, then first the GAAP conversion as per the GAAP which is being followed by the parent company, right? So GAAP conversion wherever applicable. Then there could be different year ending dates, right? The parent company and the components, they are not closing their books of account on the same date, right? So you need to do the additional checking for the different year ending dates, right? Say no, the component is closing books on 31st of December and parent is closing on 31st of March. So for those 3 months, the additional checking will have to be done. Right, then you also need to examine the subsequent events which have taken place at all the components. Right, the deferred tax, right, the deferred tax asset or the liability arising on the consolidation of the components. Then any changes in the equity attributable to the NCI, the non-controlling interest, which I could also call it as the minority shareholders. Right, up to last year it was your 70% subsidiary, this year it has become your 80% subsidiary. So that 10% adjustment will have to be done in the current year. Right, so any changes in the equity attributable to the non-controlling interest, and if any goodwill has arisen on the consolidation previously, every year when you consolidate, you need to check for any impairment losses on the goodwill arising on consolidation. Right, you need to check for any impairment losses on the goodwill arising on the consolidation. Right, is that clear to everyone? What question did I discuss with you? The current period consolidation adjustments. Right, if I come to the chapter of the public sector undertakings, right, there we have a discussion regarding the propriety audit. Right, if I come to the chapter of the audit of the public sector undertakings, there we have a question regarding the propriety audit. Right, what is the aim of propriety audit? Right, to find out cases of the improper, avoidable and the wasteful expenditure, even though if the expenditure has been incurred in accordance with the rules, regulations and the orders. Right, so for that the auditor needs to look into the wisdom, the faithfulness and the economy of the transaction. Right, so to find out cases of unnecessary, extravagant, improper expenditure, a propriety audit is conducted. Right, the CNAG has issued some norms of financial propriety, some principles of financial propriety. Right, what are those principles of financial propriety? Right, four principles of financial propriety have been laid down. First one, that expenditure should not be prima facie more than what the occasion demands. Right, whatever expenditure is being incurred out of the government funds, it should not be prima facie more than what the occasion demands. Second one, no authority should exercise power which is directly or indirectly to its own advantage. Right? No authority should exercise power which is directly or indirectly to its own advantage. That is simple words, there should be no misutilization of the power given to the various governmental authorities. Third one, the public money, it's the name itself is public money. Right, public money should not be utilized for the benefit of a particular person or section or community of the society. Right, it should be for the benefit of all the people in the society. And the allowances given to the government employee should not be a source of profit to the recipients. Right, there should be no other income. Right, the allowances given to the government employee should not be a source of profit to the recipients. What are these? These are the principles of financial propriety. Expenditure should not be prima facie more than what the occasion demands. Then no authority should exercise power which is directly or indirectly to its own advantage. Then public money should not be utilized for the benefit of a particular person, section, community of the society. And the allowances given to the government employee should not be a source of profit to the recipients. Right? Along with propriety audit, we also have the performance audit over there. Right, wherein you check the government expenditure against a preset criteria that whether the objectives of the government expenditure have been achieved or not. It is an independent and systematic examination of any government program, project, activity after it has been completed. right, to check whether the criteria are being achieved or not. And in performance audit, you have the three E's: the efficiency audit, economy audit, and the effectiveness audit. Right, efficiency, the input output ratio. Right, for a given quantity of input, what is the output? Minimum input, maximum output. Right, best combination of input output. So that's the efficiency. Economy, the optimum utilization of the resources. And effectiveness, that whether the targeted objectives of the government expenditure, of the government program, project, activity, whether those are being achieved or not. Right, whether it is overlapping with any government policy, duplicating any government policy, what is the socio-economic impact, what recommendations would you do for improving the policy expenditure further. Right, so that's the effectiveness audit. Right, so very important in the chapter of the audit of public sector undertakings, okay, that is the efficiency, economy, a performance audit is the efficiency audit, economy audit, and the effectiveness audit. Right, efficiency audit, effectiveness audit, we can also expect a retail question in the exam. Okay, these chapters, no, like audit of public sector undertakings, then you have the special aspects of auditing in an automated environment, or of course you have the chapter on the CIS audit, right? Then you have a few important questions in the chapter of the SEBI LODR. Okay, then consolidated financial statements, few important questions, investigation, due diligence, right? So many other. Rather, if I try to make a list, I'll mention the entire only, audit of NBFCs and all those. Okay, these chapters are, you know, they have their own, what you say, advantage. They have their own benefit. Like, you know, studying standard, ethics, CARO, tax audit, GST audit, that has their own benefit, has their own drawback. Okay? There is no end to it. It is like limitless. Finally, you can't even guess, you know, regarding what question could be asked in the exam, what is the, how you write the answer, case study, what clicks to you and all. But these particular, no, these are like, look small, but their power is very big. Like in Marathi, they say, you know, Murti Lahan, Kirti Mahan. And it looks very small, but you know, the power of these chapters is very big. They are very scoring. But anyways, we can't look into the advantages of any and rely on any one of them. That is so a thumb rule for the study of audit, that we have to go for a weighted average. Right? So we have to take the best of everything. That has to be the approach for studying the subject. Right? So I always tell in my regular classes, shouldn't happen that you are studying only standard, ethics, CARO, and then other chapters, you just brush them up or you don't look into them. No, it has to be a combination, congruence of both. And you study little bit of standard, 1 hour, then 1 hour you do some other chapter. Say next day you study ethics, then one remaining chapter. So you take it along together. Okay. Right. Okay. Chances of professional ethics in the exam, I've already told you it is 12-15 marks. Right, 12 to 15 marks being asked in the exams from ethics. Okay, dry, yes, the topics which are, yes, supported, a drop of water makes a mighty ocean. Okay, so whatever way, yes, I'm able to understand the concepts well, but not able to memorize. You have to revise it again and again, because only the best way to remember something is to forget it. And a very good example I can give you for that is that, you know, 1 year you forget somebody's birthday. Okay, then next year onwards, most probably, you remember it. Okay, last year I'd forgotten, or last time. So the best way, you know, to remember anything is that you should forget it. Okay, but now that you've forgotten it, that realization should not happen in the exam hall. Otherwise, it will be a blunder. You understand? No, that realization has to happen in your first, second revision, which is going on. And at that time, you know, that space should be, that empty space should be created. Okay, oh, there is no, you try to open the file, you open the cupboard, there is no data entry over there. Right, and then now you see it is empty. So now you put the new data over there. So this time, you know, put more Fevicol and stick the data. So it should stick more permanently. Because what happened, you put it, it flies away. You put it, it flies away. And this is what happens. It is not your phenomena or any other student phenomena. It is every student phenomena, only the intensity is different. You know, it's like a bird which comes and sits on a tree. For some time it sits, then it flies away. It comes and sits and flies away. So now what you have to do, you have to cage the bird. Now, so there are many ways in which you can, you know, discuss these points. Okay. Right, so now coming further, ma'am, please provide any contact for queries. So you please send me a mail on rtnlahoti9@gmail.com, or I've also recently started, opened another email ID called as rtlahotilifeclasses@gmail.com. Right, so you send me a mail on those and I'll be replying to your queries. Okay, One more before I go to the chapter on the GST audit is the resignation of the statutory auditors, which is now discussed, recently come in the RTP May 20 in the chapter of the audit committee and corporate governance. Right, I'm assuming everybody is paying attention to me, everybody is sitting straight, and everybody knows that right now the heading which I have said is resignation of the statutory auditor, which has come in the RTP May 20 in the chapter of audit committee and corporate governance. Right? Is it clear to everyone? Okay. Right. So, resignation of the statutory auditor. It says once you become a listed entity, timely disclosures are required to be made to the stock exchanges. Right? Regarding whatever event activity happens at the company, timely disclosures are required to be made at the stock exchanges. Right, the role of the audit committee in case of a listed entity, there are some 21, 23 points in the role of audit committee. But one of the very crucial role of the audit committee is regarding the appointment of the statutory auditor. Right, the terms of reappointment of the statutory auditor, the remuneration of the statutory auditor. Right, the recommendation for the appointment of the statutory auditor, all that comes under the role of the audit committee. Right. Okay. So that's like, you know, the introduction part, which is given in the RTP May 20. Okay. If you look at the RTP May 20 amendment video part 2 on YouTube, you will find this discussion over there also. Right. So I'm just putting it in a nutshell right now. Right. So resignation of statutory auditors of listed entities and their material subsidiaries. That is the heading. Then it says timely disclosures are to be made to the stock exchanges. Then the role of the audit committee in case of a listed entity. Then in case if the auditor of a listed entity resigns within 24 hours of the receipt of such reasons from the auditor, the detailed reasons are to be submitted by the listed entity to the stock exchanges. Okay, so listed entities, say example Jio Limited, right now they receive the resignation of the auditor, right? So from right now, within 24 hours, the listed entity has to submit to the stock exchanges the detailed reasons as to why their statutory auditor has resigned, right? This one I expect to be asked in the MCQ. Right, this one I expect to be asked in the MCQ, right? Within 24 hours, is the auditor required to give the details to the stock exchange? Those who are saying yes, that means you are not paying attention. Pay attention. What so much of brain fog is there that you can't, there is no clarity of mind. You know, it's as if, you know, when the rain and something, it's what you say during the winters, early morning, when you want to drive your car, there's so much of fog and smog that it's very difficult to see the road ahead. You know, when you study, your situation is always, you know, brain fog. You're not able to concentrate. And no excuses. The basic is that how to remove the excuses. No, the thing is you should not have excuses only. Okay. Right. So the listed entity within 24 hours of the receipt of reasons from the auditor is required to submit the detailed reasons to the stock exchanges. Okay. So now there is a fear that at any point of time, if auditor thinks that this audit dangerous, fraud or so, he may resign. So it says there has to be some remote control, you know, to regulate the auditor also. So now SEBI LODR has said that if the auditor resigns within 45 days from the end of the quarter, right? Listen to me carefully, these next three points. If the statutory auditor of the listed entity or its material subsidiaries resign within 45 days from the end of the quarter, right, within 45 days from the end of such quarter, so say example 4 quarters in a year, June, September, December, March, so say after 30th September, say he's resigned on 15th of October, right, so 30th September, one quarter over, right, and now he's resigned on 15th of October, so that is within 45 days from the end of the quarter. What does it say? He cannot suffer, you know, he cannot leave the office. He cannot complete his, the resignation would be accepted only after he submitted his limited review or the audit report for such quarter. Right? So if he resigns within 45 days from the end of the quarter, he has to issue the limited review or the audit report for such quarter. So 30th September audit report or limited review report he has to issue before resigning. Okay, now this is if he resigns within 45 days. What if he resigns after 45 days? Say now the auditor resigns, say on 17th of September. Okay, so now entire month of October, right? So 31 days of October and also say more than 17 days of November, right? So is that more than 45 days from the end of the September quarter? Yes. So in that case, it says the auditor cannot resign unless and until he submitted the limited review audit report for such quarter and also the next quarter. So after 45 days, if you resign, then 30th, like I'm taking example of 30th September. So September quarter also and December quarter also, and only then auditor you can resign. Okay, so it says like you can't just pick up your bag and go away. No, you have to complete whatever work is there at the onset right now. Right? Are you understanding that? And the third one, notwithstanding the above two, within 45 days and after 45 days, if the auditor resigns after finishing the audit or the limited review of the first three quarters, right? He's finished the June, September, December, three quarters audit or limited review he's completed. And now say in the month of January or February, he's resigning. It says he cannot resign unless and until he issues the audit report for the or the limited review report for the last quarter and the audit report for such financial year. Right. So if he resigns after the end of the three quarters, he has to issue the audit report, limited review report for the last quarter and also the audit report for the such financial year, that is for the entire financial year. Right. So those are these three points very much again expected in the MCQs to come in the exams, that is regarding within 45 days from the end of the quarter, after 45 days from the end of the quarter, and then third one over there is after the completion of the audit or the limited review for the first three quarters. Right. Is that clear to everyone? Wonderful. Right. So now coming to our discussion, which was originally planned for today, which is the discussion regarding the tax audit. The discussion regarding the GST audit. Right. So GST audit, right. Lot of questions due to be asked in the exam so far. They've started asking questions like, you know, the unbilled revenue and regarding RTP May 20 that the client is required to file the monthly returns and the quarterly returns. So what preparation should be done by the client? Right. So what does it say? First, understand from the client the backup of their monthly returns. Second one, understand the eligibility for the ITC and understand the outward supplies which are being done by the client. Right. So if you look at the RTP May 20 question, right, suppose if he resigns in July, then if he resigns in July, that is the June quarter you have to consider. So then he will have to complete the audit for June or limited review for June and then he can resign. Okay. Right. So that same logic. Okay. I've just taken an example only of the, right, I've just taken an example of the September quarter. Right. So GST audit, right? So what did I tell you? RTP May 20, there is a question that as an auditor, how would he prepare for this GST audit, monthly returns and all which are to be filed by the registered person. So it says understand the backup of the monthly return, then understand the eligibility of the ITC and also understand the outward supplies. Okay. And then one question which is being hoarded in the RTP for a very long time is regarding the types of audits under the GST law. Right, one, you have the audit by the professional where the aggregate annual turnover exceeds 2 crore of the registered person. Second one is the general audit under the GST law, which could be conducted by the GST authorities themselves. Right, and the third one is regarding the special audit under the GST law. Right, so certainly I expect a question on this one. Right, the special audit under the GST law. Right, now who can direct a special audit under the GST law? Right, a GST authority not below the rank of the assistant commissioner. Right, he can direct the special audit under the GST law. Right, at what point of time can a special audit be directed under the GST law? It says at any point of time after initiation and before completion of any scrutiny, inquiry, investigation, or any proceedings under the GST law. Right. So at what point of time a special audit can be directed under the GST law? Right. After initiation and before completion of any scrutiny, inquiry, investigations under the various proceedings under the GST law. Right. What are the circumstances when such a special audit could be directed under the GST law? What are the circumstances? Right. Two circumstances. What are the two? Right, not below the rank of assistant commissioner, section 66, okay, scrutiny. Right, what are the two circumstances where a special audit could be directed under the GST law? Interest of revenue, okay. Anytime? No. After inquiry, after initiation and before completion. That I've already discussed. Nature and complexity of accounts, not really. Right, what are the two circumstances when you can direct a special audit under the GST law? Okay, Manikanta is mentioning after initiation, before completion. Yes, inquiry, investigation, assistant commissioner. Okay, at the yes, of the client or at their office, at the premises, okay, nature and complexity, no, 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 you're all telling on your own, right? These are like, you know, self-created answers, okay, 90 days, 90 days, it has, the report has to be submitted within 90 days, or further it can be extended by more 90 days. Right, yes, Javed Akhtar, yes, is mentioning that value has not been correctly declared, or the credit of, yes, or the second one over there is what? The credit availed is not within the normal limits. Right, so, you know, now this is a point of difference. See, because of, like, I want to revise it with you, I'm mentioning the point. And once I mention the point for you to assert, okay, this is the point, that is easy. As compared to when I stop and I want you to tell the point and I want to check that whether it is correct, then you come to know that what is the exact situation, what is the exact level of preparation that is your, yes, or exact level of preparation of yours. Right, so what are the circumstances when a special audit can be directed under the GST law? One, where the value has not been correctly declared or the credit availed is not within the normal limits. Right, value has not been correctly declared or the credit availed is not within the normal limits, then they can direct a special audit under the GST law. Right, then another question which we have over there is regarding the preparation for the GST audit. Right, so now say special audit has been directed and now the special audit is to be done by CA or CMA, whosoever is appointed by the commissioner. Right, so what are the preparations which is required to be done for the GST audit? Right, so what preparation required for the GST audit? Yes, value, credit, credit availed is not within the normal limits. Wonderful. Right, so what is now the preparation? Next retail question which I am coming to over there. Right, what is the preparation required for a GST audit? One, you need to check the applicability. Right, that which type of GST audit? Is it an audit by professional or whether it is any special audit which has been called for by the GST authorities? Right, so the applicability. Right, then the eligibility, that whether the CA, CMA, whether he is qualified to do the GST audit for the client. Like, you know, for the client, if he is doing the internal audit, then he is not going to be qualified to do the GST audit. Right, so the applicability and also the eligibility. Applicability of GST audit for the client, okay, is GST audit applicable to the registered person? And second one is the eligibility. Are you eligible to do the audit under the GST law? Right, once you have checked the applicability and you have checked the eligibility, now KOC, right, knowledge of the client's business, right, understanding the nature of operations, the books of account being maintained by the company and registered person, right, regarding the purchase, sale, stock, right, and the input tax credit availed, the expenses, income of the entity, internal controls at the registered person. So understand, right, understand the nature of business, the nature of operations at the registered person. Right, so what was the first point? The applicability. Second one, the eligibility. Right, third one, the KOC. Then after that, now you prepare a detailed questionnaire, right, covering all aspects at the client place which you would like to understand, right, which covers all the various areas which you want to, you know, gain an understanding regarding before proceeding with the GST audit. Because right now we are not talking about how to do the GST audit, we are talking about the preparation for the GST audit. Right, we are talking about the preparation for the GST audit. Right, so that is the next one, the preparation of the questionnaire. Then based on the answers to the questionnaire, now GST auditor, you will prepare a detailed audit program. Now based on the questionnaire, GST auditor, you will prepare a detailed audit program. And then also you need to ask the client for the relevant reconciliation. Right, so the host of the relevant reconciliations. Right, that's a very important question over there regarding the preparation for the GST audit. Right, what is the preparation for the GST audit which is required? Applicability, then eligibility, then KOC, questionnaire, detailed audit program, and then the host of relevant reconciliations. Wonderful. Okay, and now we will come to the analysis of the GSTR 9C. Right, everybody pay attention. Right, in the MCQs, right, in the theory, in the case studies, I expect lot of questions, right, to be coming from this GSTR 9C. Right, so GSTR 9C, the serial number 1 over there, starting with the FY, that is the financial year. Right, everybody with me? Right, we've now started discussing regarding the analysis of the GSTR 9C. Right, so list of books of account, reconciliation, okay, wonderful. Right, so you're all replying. So again, that replying is very important if you, you know, reply regarding the topic. So that mentions about your alertness. Yes, GST, that is the point which you've mentioned, that is regarding another question. What are the best practices to be adopted for audit under the GST law? This is a separate question I discussed right now, preparation for GST audit. And what I'm understanding today is that, you know, your best practices for GST audit, that is what I'm telling now, that is a different question. The question which I discussed right now was regarding the preparation for GST audit. What I have identified today is that now you know the answers, you know the questions, but you don't know which question, which answer to be written. You know, you have to do the match the following. Like, you know, say here on left hand side, the states of India are given, and on the right hand side, the capitals of those states have been given in a random manner. Then you have to do the matching, no? Like Maharashtra is mentioned over here and Mumbai is mentioned down. So then you need to link that. Are you understanding? Because right now I am asking one question and the first thought coming to your mind is some different answer coming. If the correct answer is coming, wonderful, nothing like it. But if some cross connection is taking place, that means one level down. Okay, so that's, you know, you have to do the finishing of that part. Okay, right. So now they started discussing financial year, GST identification number, wonderful. Right, then after that, the legal name, trade name, 3A, 3B, and then you have 4. Are you liable to audit under any other act? Right, so now I'm talking about the analysis of the GSTR 9C. Right, what is the serial number 1, 2, 3, 4 over there? Financial year, GST identification number, then the legal name 3A, then 3B, if trade name, in case if the trade name is different, if it is the same, no problem, only you mention the legal name in that case. And then 4, are you liable to audit under any other act? Right, and now we come to the fifth point, right? What is the fifth point over there? Reconciliation of the total turnover. Right, reconciliation of the turnover. Right, and now in 5, right, under the fifth point, we have 5A, right, up to 5R. Right, it goes 5A, 5B, right up to 5R. Okay, starting with 5A, which is, yes, due to technical issue, could not access the first half. Okay, so no problem. You can see it later on the YouTube channel. Okay. Right, so now 5A, right, what is 5A? It is regarding the turnover as per the audited annual financial statement. So starting point for calculating turnover as per the GST law, you take the turnover as per the audited annual financial statements. That is the 5A. Now to 5A, we are going to add 5 things, right, 5B, C, D, E and F. Right, B, 5B, IS unbilled revenue at the beginning of the financial year. C, unadjusted advances at the end of the financial year. D, the deemed supply. E, credit notes issued after the end of the financial year. And F is regarding the trade discounts, right, which are not permissible under the GST law. Right, so now after 5A, 5B, C, D, E and F, we are talking about 5 additions. Right, what is the first addition? 5B, unbilled revenue at the beginning of the financial year. Let us understand, because May 19 question in the old course has been asked on this one. So new course for you, this question is still awaited. Right, unbilled revenue at the beginning of the financial year. Say I am talking about the GST return for 2019-20. Right, 2019-20. Okay, so that means last year was 2018-19. Right, now as per AS9, as per the accounting standard, we have a concept of unbilled revenue. Right, so like, you know, something called as the percentage work in progress, you know, the percentage completion of work. According to that, you recognize the revenue. Okay, so say 31st March 2019, when you closed your books of account, there was some work which was completed for which the bill was yet to be raised, but you recognized it as a revenue while closing your books of account for 31st of March 2019. So did you raise the bill to the client for that revenue in that year? Did you raise the invoice to the client? No. So has GST been charged on the same? No. But has it already been recognized as revenue in the previous financial year, 31st March 2019? Yes. Now I am talking under 5A regarding the turnover as per annual financial statements for 19-20. So this unbilled revenue at the end of the previous financial year, that is there in the revenue of 18-19, that is not there in the revenue of 19-20. Pay attention. Are you understanding? But for GST purpose, the billing is going to be done in the current year. So this year you're going to pay the GST on the same. So last year, whatever unbilled revenue was there for which billing is going to be happening into the current year, that we need to add it under 5B. Unbilled revenue at the beginning of the financial year. Obviously, last year it is end of the financial year, so carry forward of that to the current year for which the billing would be done in the current year. So in the books of account, it has been recognized as revenue in the previous years only, but for GST purposes, the billing would be done in the current year. That is what you need to add under 5B. Right? Is it clear to everybody? Right? Unbilled revenue at the beginning of the financial year 5B. Right? Then 5C, unadjusted advances at the end of the financial year. Because again, these are the advances which are not recognized as revenue in the current year. But because it is in advance, the billing would be done in the current year. So that is why you again add it to the revenue. Right? So unbilled revenue at the beginning of the financial year, add. Unadjusted advances at the end of the financial year, add. 5C. Right? Then 5D is regarding the deemed supply. What comes under deemed supply? The permanent transfer or disposal of a business asset. Right, then transfer from principal to agent, of agent to principal, or the transfer of assets between the related persons or the distinct persons. Right, that comes under the deemed supply. So as such, as per books of account, it is not included in turnover, but for GST purpose, it is to be considered as a part of turnover. So that is why you add the deemed supply. Right, so 5A, that is the annual turnover as per the audited financial statements. 5B, unbilled revenue at the beginning of the financial year. Do writing practice of the case study for this one today. Right, then 5C, unadjusted advances at the end of the financial year. Deemed supply, again, I expect a retail question to be asked in the exam. Right, the deemed supply. 5E, the credit notes, right, at the end of the financial year, which are again to be included in the turnover for GST law. And trade discount, which is normally taken as a deduction and the books of account, but not allowed as a deduction under the GST law, that we need to add it to turnover over here. Right, so trade discounts, again, you need to add it to turnover. Right, so that is B, C, D, E, and F. Right, then after that, now we come to G2 further up to M. Right, L. Right, we come further up to G to L. Right, G, now G to L, you have to reduce. G, H, I, J, K, L. Right, these 6 points you need to reduce. First 5 points we added to turnover as per audited financial statements. Next 5 points we are going to reduce from turnover as per the annual audited annual financial statements. Right, so 5G is the turnover from April to June 2017, not every year, only that year, because the law became applicable from 1st of July. Right, so now not very relevant when I'm talking about 1920 or so. Right, so that is 5G. Then 5H, unbilled revenue at the end of the financial year. Because at the beginning of the financial year, you're adding. So at the end of the financial year, that is there. 1920 unbilled revenue is there in 5A. But for that, billing will be done in the next year. So that I need to reduce. Previous year, I need to add. And this year, unbilled revenue, I need to reduce. Right? So unbilled revenue at the end of the financial year, reduce. Then 5I, unbilled, unadjusted advances at the beginning of the financial year, reduce. Right? Because for that, the billing is already done in the previous year. Right? So unadjusted advances at the beginning of the financial year. Then any credit notes, right, which are to be reduced from the turnover. Right? Then after that, you have the supply to any SEZ DTA units. Right? Supply to any SEZ DTA units. Right? So not to be included in the, it is there in the turnover of 5A, but it is not to be considered in the turnover as per the GST law. Right? So that is why next you reduce the supply to SEZ DTA units, and next one the turnover for which the registered person is going to pay the GST under the composition scheme. Right? So say for few of the, what do you say, the premises or the branches from where the entity is operating, there they have opted for the composition scheme under the GST law. Right? So that we need to reduce it from the turnover of 5A. Right? So this is the minus 6. Right, then after this minus 6, we have the 5M, we have the 5N, and we have the 5O. Right, so M, N, O could be plus, it could be minus. Right, it could be plus or it could be the minus. Right, first 5B to F is further, those 5 points over there was plus 5. Then we had the minus 6. Now it could be plus or minus 3. right? Plus or minus 3, any difference in the value of the turnover due to the valuation rules under section 15 of the GST law. Right, so the turnover as per books is different, and the turnover coming as per the valuation rules of section 15 is different. So that you need to do the adjustment over here. It could be plus or it could be minus. That is 5M. Right. Then after that you have the 5N. 5N, again a very important one. Question asked in the exams. I expect the question to be repeated. This again May 19. It has been asked for the old course. So new course, the question yet to be asked for you people. The foreign exchange fluctuation. Right, the adjustments in turnover. I'm talking about the heading 5N. 5N, what does it say? The adjustment in turnover due to the foreign exchange fluctuation. Right, adjustments in the turnover due to the foreign exchange fluctuation. Right, so what you need to do if there is any forex gain that you need to reduce, and if there is any forex loss that you need to add it to the turnover. Right, remember the thumb rule. If there is any forex gain that you need to reduce, and if there is any forex loss that you need to add to the turnover, right? We also have the case studies for this one, right? So you can check into the RTP and in the analysis of GSTR 9C, right? So that is, forex gain is to be reduced and forex loss is to be added to the turnover. And 5O is the balancing figure for any other reasons which are not covered above. Right, so that goes right from 5A up to 5O. Then we have the 5P, which will be auto populated based on this plus minus and the plus minus. Right, then 5Q, you take the turnover which has been declared in the annual return. Everywhere we do this now. Turnover as per the whatever, the amount as calculated above, then the amount which is declared in the annual return. Right, and then the difference and then the reasons. Right, then you look into the difference and then you look into the reasons. Right, so that is, then you come to the 5P, which is the auto-populated, 5Q, turnover as declared in the annual return, 5R will be the reasons, 5R will be the difference, right, the unreconciled turnover, if there is a difference between 5P minus 5Q, and 6, you have to give the reasons, right, in 6, you have to, serial number 6, you have to give the reasons for the unreconciled turnover, right. So far, is it clear to everyone? So what is 5? It is regarding the reconciliation of the total turnover. And 6, you have to give the reasons for any unreconciled turnover. Right, so 1, 2, 6. Now coming to 7, which is regarding the reconciliation of the taxable turnover. Right, so now coming to 7, which is regarding the reconciliation is fiscal audit. Right, credit notes not admissible should be added. Okay. Right, so forex, right, what is the question? Okay, exempt supply composition scheme. Okay, unreconciled turnover, right, GSTR 9C, audited financial statements to GSTR 9 to unreconciled turnover, right? Suresh Babu, you've put it very correctly over there, right? How to learn this? You have to remember, you have to, you know, study, read it, write it 3-4 times. So that will, you know, help you to keep it in your mind, right? So right now we come to 7, okay, now where you have share, you can just type on Google and the GSTR 9C, and the GSTR 9C, which is originally issued by the GST authorities, that will come in front of you, right? Half of your life goes in searching for PDF documents and videos. Okay, like, you know, I was just thinking the other day, if you have to tell the student that, you know, you should avoid your distraction of social media. But, you know, even to make a video on avoiding destruction of social media, even for that, the video has to be put on social media only, no? And it's like a dharam sankat, you know, it's like a big, paradox, it's an irony. Like I say, if I want to put a video on distraction, you know, how to avoid distraction from social media. Okay, but now that video itself I'll have to put on social media. So then I thought, my God, this is now a very difficult situation to assess. Okay, I have absolutely no preferences or anything. You all decide on your own, because it is your marks, your destiny. You are the perfect creators. Nobody else can create your life the way you can create. Yes, you are your own masterpiece to take charge of your situation. But I have seen students who will compare the amendment videos or the revision videos of 7-8 faculties, and then they will give a comparative analysis of which one is what. Now, what the hell, from where do you have the time on earth just to see the amendment videos of 7-8 faculties?
I'm like, you know, very thankful to God that when I wrote my exams in November 2008, there was no such concept of YouTube or amendment videos or anything uploaded. Whenever you've done the class, you have done the class. That's it. No amendment, nothing. Only amendments, the way in which I used to come to know about it is through the RTP. So it was assumed, you know, like we were helpless in that situation, that amendments, we have to do it on our own. And for you, in your case, you're spoiled with choices, right? So same amendment, you can keep on studying as if the entire paper is 100 marks is going to come on the amendment only. And you please decide regarding how your time is required to be utilized. Okay, every moment, every second of the day, you know, the clock is ticking. Okay, it is just a matter of time, okay, that the month of July, when your exams are scheduled, that will come. Then obviously as scheduled, the September or whenever your results are to come, that will come, right? So it's just a matter of time. So what you do in the present moment with that time is very, very important, right? And then you again wasted all this time, and then again October, your situation, you know, just jahan pe the. And you again continue to, you know, अरे अभी तो ये GST audit that ma'am had put, you know, revision video. She was coming live for 8 days. I went live for those 8 days to see video. 9:58 I used to get up if 10 o'clock the class used to be there. And now again, you know, I don't want you to be the viewers of my video when I upload, take the YouTube live sessions for November. And that is what you do for me. I want new subscribers. I want new people to see my video. Obviously, if you don't clear, then you come again to see. But I don't want that to happen with you. I want to see your YouTube videos. You know, you join a big four, you become a CFO of a company, and you're talking about your experiences over there. Give me also an opportunity to see, na? Right? Okay, wonderful. Somebody is saying that ma'am dara rahe ho. I am not required to scare you. That work is being done by ICAI. Okay, and if you are scared, very good, then you should get good, more marks. Okay, so to some extent being fearful is also very good, no? Okay. Oh, 100% sure, wonderful. Ankit Agarwal, he's saying perfect, that he is going to study very well now. So Ankit, I want a merit rank from you. Abhi jang baki hai aur main hara nahi hu. Oh, very good. Huh? Ram, my YouTube channel. Okay, somebody is saying, madam, follow my YouTube channel. Okay, once I get time, I will do that. Okay, right now I am a bit busy. Okay, right, and I wish I always should be busy. That is my, I just pray to God, you know, that keep me in such a position in life that I'm always busy. Okay, wonderful. Right, so we are talking about 7, serial number 7, which is regarding the reconciliation of the taxable turnover. Are you all with me, paying attention? Sure, ma'am, we will pass. Okay, wonderful. Right, those some of you, I don't even want to read out, you know, some of the points in the chat, because that's, I can't, I have a particular thing regarding what I can accept. I have a filter put over there. Wonderful, right? Some of you, your casualness and approach, okay, it's not, you know, I don't know these people, what do they think of themselves? No end probably, but everybody has their own style. Okay. Ma'am, is it required to study any MCQ book? Yes, pick up one book, finish that, buy the next book, finish that, buy the next book, finish that, buy the next book, finish that, till the day of exam comes. Please do keep doing that. MCQ practice, every time you study audit, you have to study 10-15 minutes of MCQ. Right? Some 10-15 MCQs you have to see every day. To begin with, you can see these 9 series, you know, the MCQ videos which I've put on the YouTube. I've made a playlist of those. Okay. Wonderful. Reconciliation of the taxable turnover. That is 7A. That is 7. Then 7A is what you take from 5P. What is 5P? The auto populated after the plus 5, minus 6 and the plus minus 3. That is the 5P. So under 7A, what comes is the 5P. Right? Then 7B, 7C and 7D. Now we need to reduce 3 things in order to come to the taxable turnover. Right? What do you reduce under 7B? Right, the no supply, the nil rated supply, the non-GST supply and the exempted supply. Again, the next area, right, from where I expect your question for you. Right, no supply, right? So it is not considered to be a supply for the purpose of GST. Second one, nil rated supplies where the GST rate is zero. Right now there are no under this category. Non-taxable turnover where the tax is not to be paid under the GST law, but the tax is to be payable under any other law. And exempted supplies where they are partially or wholly exempted from the payment of GST. Like example, milk, water, health, education, service and so on. Okay, right. So we are talking about the 7A, which is coming from the 5P, then 7B, where you reduce these four supplies: no supply, non-GST supply, the nil rated supplies and the exempted supplies. Right, everybody, are you understanding this? What do we reduce under 7B? We reduce the no supply, the non-GST supply, the nil rated supplies and the exempted supplies. Right, then after that, under 7C, we reduce the zero rated supplies. Right, what comes under the zero rated supplies? One, the exports, and second, the supply to the SEZ. Right, the exports being done, which will not be considered under the taxable turnover because for that the customs would be applicable. And second one, the supply to the SEZ. Right, so that is the 7C. Right, then 7D, where the GST is to be paid on a reverse charge basis. So where the recipient is going to pay the GST. So you are not liable to pay it over here. So that you need to reduce. Right, so wherever it is mentioned in the bill, that means you have to pay. But if it is not mentioned in the bill, that means the recipient is going to pay. So that you need to reduce it under 7D. Right, so 7B, 7C, 7D, very, very important. What is 7B? No supply, nil rated supply, non-GST supply and the exempted supply. Right, 7C is regarding the zero rated supplies. What comes under zero rated supply? The exempted supply, sorry, the exports and the supply to the SEZ. Right, and then you have the 7D, which is under the reverse charge. 7E, auto populated. Right, 7F, the turnover, taxable turnover as declared under the annual return, right, and GSTR 9. Right, 7F, the difference, and say then 8, you give the reasons. Right, and 8, you give the reasons. Right, so that is the reconciliation of the taxable turnover. Right, 5 was regarding the reconciliation of the total turnover. 7 is regarding the reconciliation of the taxable turnover. 8 is again the reason. Right, and 9, you have the reconciliation of the ITC. Right, what is 9? It is regarding the reconciliation of the ITC. Right, so again, ITC availed as per the audited annual financial statements. Right, then over there you have the 9A, where you are going to add 9B, where ITC claimed in the current year, ITC expenditure claimed in some earlier year, booked in some earlier year, but claimed in the current financial year. Right, so booked in earlier year but claimed in current financial year, and that you need to add. And what you need to less, claim booked in current financial year but to be claimed in the subsequent financial year, that you need to less. Right, so what are you going to add over here? Booked in earlier financial year but claimed in current financial year, add. And booked in current financial year but to be claimed in subsequent financial year, that you are going to less. Right, then you will get the ITC as per the after the above calculation. Then compare it with the ITC as declared in the GSTR 9. Again, you will get the unreconciled ITC, the difference. Right, and 10, you need to write down the reason. Right, 11 is regarding the additional tax liability. Right, 11 is regarding the additional tax liability. Right, then again 12, you have the reconciliation of the ITC on a gross basis, then reconciliation, the breakup of the reconciliation of ITC, and then final over there you have the additional tax liability. Right, then you have the additional tax liability. Right, so where do I expect the questions in the exam over here? Right, one is regarding the unbilled revenue at the beginning of the financial year. Then I expect a question on the deemed supply, right? Then I expect a question on that no, nil, non-rated, right? Those supplies, exempted supplies. Then I expect a question on the foreign exchange fluctuation, right? Forex gain you need to reduce and forex loss you need to add. Right, so on the foreign exchange fluctuation, a question is expected to be asked in the exam. Then on reverse charge, right, reverse charge mechanism, there a question expected. Special audit under the GST law, circumstances when a special audit can be directed, who can direct the special audit to be done, when can the special audit be directed. So special audit, we can expect a question. Preparation for GST audit, best practices to be adopted for audit under the GST law. Right, so that could be the entire discussion, right, regarding the GST audit. Right, so we have managed to have our discussion regarding the tax audit yesterday, and today we discussed a few other questions also, and then we also came to the discussion on the GST audit. Right, so today what you can do is you can go through the entire GSTR 9C serial number wise by serial number wise. And if you look at the RTP May 19, November 19, you know, when initially first time the GSTR 9C was included in your syllabus. Okay, after many of those heading, under many of those serial number, they've given some case studies. If you have the AS Foundation book, and that also you'll see that after say 5N, which is regarding foreign exchange fluctuation, you'll see the case studies over there. Right, if you come to reverse chart 7D, you'll see the case studies over there. Right, unbilled revenue at the beginning of the financial year 5B, you'll see the case studies over there. Right, and if you don't have those in the tech notebook from which you are studying, best place to find them is in the RTP. Right, so May 19, November 19, any one of those two RTPs you go through and you will find the question over there. Right, and then so now whatever we finished tomorrow and day after, we will be discussing the MCQs. But apart from that, the chapters we finished, you brush up with them. And the other chapters which are not covered in this revision series, I expect you to go through those also. So, you know, one comprehensive revision or study of the subject of CA final audit would have been done. Right, so I thank you all very much and I'll see you all tomorrow. Right, thank you.